Today on the show, I'm chatting with my old college buddy, retired Navy pilot, Lieutenant Commander Stephen Cooper, call sign Booger. I, on the other hand, have only known him simply as Coop. We talk about our college days at Memphis State, traveling the world, living in Italy during a pandemic, riding a camel even, and his good old flying days in the United States Navy that sometimes even resembled a blockbuster movie. So stay tuned. Hi, everyone. This is Sandy Adams, and you're listening to a Southern Girls View podcast. Steve, welcome to the show.
Well, thanks, Sandy. I'm happy to be here.
Just a little bit. I always like to tell my listeners out there how I know you, and I've literally known you since I was probably 19 years old, which was like yesterday.
A couple of years ago, yeah.
We actually met, I think, did we meet our freshman year in college? I can't remember if it was freshman or sophomore year.
I think it was sophomore year. I was living off campus my freshman year.
That's odd. Okay, I didn't know that. Maybe I did know that because you were living with Farhan, right? Was that afterwards?
That was afterwards.
Okay. But anyway, I've known you for that many years, and you are part of a circle of my college friends who I just feel are like family. And no matter how many years have gone by, we still keep in touch, and it's just like yesterday. And anyway, I've been after you for almost a year to do this interview. So you're actually coming to us live from Naples, Italy, is where you're living right now.
I'm a little busy lately.
Yeah, a little busy, yes. So let's just kind of talk about what you currently do, like what your current job is, and kind of how the pandemic is affecting your area of Italy.
A good topic. I'm the air terminal manager for the Navy at an Italian commercial airfield in Naples, Italy, at Capo d'Aquino Airport. So there is an international airport, and on each side of the airport is a military installation. On one side is the Italian Air Force, and on the other side is the U.S. Navy. So we share the airfield, and we have military operations that support NATO troops. There's a four-star command here.
Okay.
There's a whole lot of very senior military officers that live and work in the Naples area, supporting the NATO mission and the Navy mission. So I provide a safe, clean air terminal that allows for the transportation of distinguished visitors and all of the military members and their families that come and go through the Naples area, and for other folks that are heading further along downrange.
So it is a civilian position, correct? What your job?
I am a civil service civilian, yes. Okay. So I work for the federal government.
And you just recently moved back there, correct? You just recently?
Yes. I retired from the Navy in the summer of 2010 from Naples, Italy. We had lived here for 4 years, and my babies had grown up here, started going to school here, learned to speak a little bit of Italian, and considered this home when we moved away, and they wanted to come back home.
Wow, well, yes.
It took 10 years, but we came back, and now they feel at home already.
Oh, that's awesome. Back,
yeah, we've been back since the end of July last year. What's going on?
So tell us a little bit about the pandemic, because it obviously you guys started feeling the effects of it pretty much before the U.S. did.
Yeah, by about 2 to 3 weeks. So we were closer to the ground zero, for lack of a better term, of the event happening. And they're tracing back through how it spread so quickly. And it was within, you know, a couple of days of it leaving China before it made it to Italy.
Right.
So people were traveling by air, and that's how it happened.
How has it affected your job currently, other than you're working at home some?
Well, about 2 weeks ago, we stopped all travel back and forth. Italy became the second place that people couldn't fly into or out of securely anymore after China. So, first China was quarantined, and then, Iran also had a lot of activity, but people weren't quite aware of it yet because not a lot of people go through Iran on their way anywhere else. But people come through Italy quite a lot, and it's a tourist destination. So information got out about the cases in Italy going up, especially in northern Italy. And it happened very, very quickly. It was hard to take seriously because, you know, of sensationalism in the media and the language barrier here. So I would say the Americans in Italy, you know, we're used to sensational media. So when we hear it, we don't react quite the same way as the rest of the world does when they hear a sensational story.
Right.
The Italians took it very seriously and were wondering why we weren't taking it as seriously as they were. Now we understand why.
Right. Right. We were talking before we started recording this episode that you don't even have internet currently. You're having to use your phone internet because it's out in the house. And you were talking about that. Is that a part of the infrastructure problem there in Italy, or is it something else?
Well, it's both. The infrastructure has vastly improved in the 10 years since we left and come back.
Right.
However, right now, because of the pandemic and the fact that for the last 2.5-3 weeks now, the entire nation has been on lockdown.
Yes.
So if you're not an essential worker performing an essential function, you stay at home. And if you have to go get medicine for the family or go get groceries, you're allowed to do that. But you have to travel alone, and you have to maintain social distancing. And in most of the smaller town grocery stores around here, you have to wear gloves and a mask just to enter the store after you waited in line to get there.
Now,
supplies and everything are readily available. So the trucking systems are still working, and they're still transporting goods back and forth. But the infrastructure, the utilities, those are starting to show the strain. So, you know, it's starting to look a lot more like Italy did 10 years ago, or feel that way to people that, you know, that need services. The public utilities, they are what they are, but they're not being upkept, maintained, repaired with the same level of care that they had been before all this stuff started.
How big is Naples? Like, how many people are in the city or in the area? Like, how large is the population?
The country of Italy is 60.5 million. I believe the community of Naples is somewhere near 6 million.
So that's roughly the size of Houston, though, because Houston's about, I think, 6 million, including all the suburbs.
Yeah, in a much smaller landmass, but yes.
Yes. Here... You know, I went to the grocery store yesterday and everybody's hoarding like toilet paper and paper towels, and that's nationwide, which we all find incredibly strange that everybody as a country just decided to hoard toilet paper, because we don't even see that. Like when there's a hurricane and we have to prepare for a hurricane, we don't even see people. Like normally they buy water and food and stuff. But you go in the store, nobody's wearing gloves, nobody's wearing a mask here, and that's here in the Houston area. There's still people out and about. As much, you know, and my sister and I, because she lives in Boston, we were talking yesterday, I was talking with a friend of hers, and obviously for cities that are compacted and the people are live a lot closer and everything's much in a much smaller area, I think it is a little bit harder to do that. Here in Houston, everything is so spread out that, you know, it doesn't necessarily look like anybody's like taking any precautions. There are less people on the street, though, I will say that, and less people, like a lot of the restaurants, they can't have in dining anymore. They have to only do takeout or carry out.
Restaurants have been completely closed here for the last 2 weeks.
Wow.
You can't do take delivery, nothing. You're cooking at home or you're not eating.
And that's one thing we've seen about the grocery stores is now we realize the reason all the groceries are gone is because all the people that were eating out all the time are now buying groceries. And that just goes, you know, for us, it's like, wow, that shows you how many people just eat out all the time.
Italians do too, quite a bit, honestly. But they all eat the same food, so it's always in ready supply in the stores, even the groceries. So, you know, grandma learned how to make it, and everyone else knows how to make it the way grandma did, including the restaurants.
So, what's your
menu, Tagging menu is not extensive. It's good. It's very good, but it's pretty basic and it's not difficult to cook now that I've been here.
What's your favorite Italian meal?
Well, living in Naples, the seafood is fantastic. So, you know, an Italian meal is not, it's an event. It's not really a meal. It's a few hours out of your life that you're very happy to slow life down for.
Right.
You go out, you meet friends somewhere, preferably with a nice view.
Right.
And you have, some antipasta, meat and cheese. You have some fruit. You have a few glasses of wine while you're waiting for the courses to come out. And the courses come out and they're consumed immediately. They're not, you don't wait for the table to load up.
Right.
So they bring out a primi, a secondi, and you get a meat as a second plate. So usually the primi is a type of pasta.
Right.
So by the time you're finished, you're completely stuffed. Even if you're trying not to eat too much, it's still hard not to eat too much.
Sure.
And it just gets worse when you go inland to places that are like a Toria or an agriturismo, because these are like it's like a resort inland where you go to eat. Right. So they grow their own food, they cook their own food. It's a giant farm where they do their own thing, and you're invited to come in and have a meal with them one like a Saturday or a Sunday. Right. You'll be leaving 5 hours later, but you will be very happy you stayed for the entire time. The meals are fantastic. The food's great. The friendship's great here too.
Do you know a lot of Italian now that you've lived there twice? No.
I don't speak enough to make myself comfortable speaking in a crowd or anything. But I know enough basic Italian to communicate in the stores and the restaurants and, the gas station stuff. I mean, not really. But they usually get the point across, and I rely a lot on my previous understanding of Spanish, and I speak a lot of Italian. So I pull whatever Latin-based word I think matches up, and sometimes it does, and sometimes I it's like the dog's looking at me going,
what?
Yeah. So, but hand signals work, and Google Translate is a godsend. So
yeah, I've heard a lot of people talk about how that's really good. And they've used it a lot. Let's talk a little bit about your Navy career. I was also talking to somebody the other day. I was talking about who I was going to be interviewing. I was talking about you. And I said, I literally remember you guys were in flight school in Pensacola, the cradle of naval and marine aviation. And I remember watching the news of when we invaded Kuwait. And I remember immediately I was terrified that you guys were going to be pulled out of flight school and sent overseas. But let's talk a little bit about what you did in the Navy and kind of how that progressed over your 20 years. Was it 20 years that you were in?
I was in for 20 years. That's right. So I came into the Navy in 1990 at the end of the Ronald Reagan presidency era, where we were going to build a 500 ship Navy.
Right.
And then we had a change of leadership and the plan changed drastically. And essentially every milestone in my flight training, for lack of a better term, career, the training program, every few months you go to a different phase. They would line us all up and tell us to look left and look right. And by the time we're done, if we're still standing here, it means those two aren't. So, it was a very high attrition rate. Roughly one out of three got to go forward in progression from one to the next phase. And I got to tell you, I'm surprised that I was the last man standing there. Very happy, but surprised.
Right.
Because there were quite a lot of very talented people in that cadre, even from the beginning. And it was just, fate and fortune that I made it through. I mean, yeah, I'm not dumb, but yeah, I worked hard. Yeah. But there was a lot of luck involved with me getting to where I was. So I was very happy to have that opportunity. I went to California and flew helicopters for 4 years. And I deployed on two aircraft carriers, the Carl Vinson and the Nimitz. I went west through Japan, Singapore, Hong Kong, Thailand, Australia, Tasmania. I got to see so much of the world that I never would have had an opportunity to see otherwise. I think I went to Hawaii like 7 times.
Wow.
It's a little different though when you're going off of a ship. And yes. I don't mean a cruise ship, you know.
Yes. So what type of helicopters did you fly?
I flew H-60s off of an aircraft carrier. So it was this H-60 Foxtrot, which is an anti-submarine warfare aircraft. And then later on in that 4-year period, we incorporated a mission of combat search and rescue. So we started bringing armed helicopters into the Navy. They had used them in Vietnam, and then had gotten away from using armed helicopters for anything in the Navy from, you know, roughly the mid 70s until 1993.
Why was that?
It was someone else's job. So they left the armed helicopter mission to the Marine Corps.
Oh, okay.
And at that point, the Marine Corps started becoming their own entity yet again, instead of just a, you know, an absorbed by the Department of the Navy entity.
They right.
started branching out and doing their own thing. And they took Marines off of aircraft carriers because they didn't have the same mission that they had had before.
I didn't know that. That's interesting.
Yep. And then they started bringing them back as fighter pilots. So, you know, everything you say, it's not entirely true in any way, because so many different things happen at one time in a big organization like the Navy.
Right.
But for the most part, the Marine Corps was becoming a more independent branch of the military on their own. And they do have a different mission. And they're definitely a sister service to the Navy, and but they certainly do things differently.
How is their mission different from the Navy's mission? For the people out there that don't really know anything about the military. Yeah.
So helicopter pilots take off from ships, and Marine Corps pilots take off from ships and go to land, and they go fight and they drop troops and supplies. And once they're inland, they stay inland for a while and they support the troops on the ground of the Marines.
Okay.
You know, Navy helicopter's mission is to support the fleet. So we fly out and around ships. We protect it from submarine attacks. We haul mail back and forth between larger ships and the smaller ships. When it comes on board the COD, the COD's a small airplane that lands with, it's a cargo plane for the aircraft carrier. Well, they figure out what goes where, and they load it up on helicopters, and we take it out to the smaller ships so that they can receive their mail. And, you know, we also move refrigerated items and fresh food, vegetables, all that stuff. So we had a lot of different jobs.
Right.
In addition to the primary role of search and rescue. The reason they kept helicopters on aircraft carriers in the 70s, 80s, and 90s was primarily as a search and rescue platform for the jets. But they figured out they could give them a whole lot of other stuff to do while they were out there.
Right. That makes sense. That makes sense. You're utilizing your product to the best extent possible.
Yeah. Yeah. We got good at a lot of stuff, and I really appreciated that about the helicopter community, especially on a carrier, that you weren't stuck doing the same thing every day. Well, you were rarely doing the same thing every mission.
Was there one, and I know that's probably hard in your 20 years, but was there one flight, one mission that was a little bit stuck out as a little bit more special or a little bit more exciting or something like that?
Well, I've had my share of scary stuff happen.
Yeah, let's hear. Let's hear. Can you tell us? Do you want to tell us the scariest thing?
Well, I lived, so there's no. You know, we already know how the story ends, so that kind of ruins it right there, doesn't it? So I've had some interesting flights. I've seen some fantastic sights, and I've gone and done things that I never would have dreamed when I started doing this for a living that I would have done.
Tell us one thing. One thing you've done. That was like the most exciting.
3 o'clock in the morning in the rain, off the coast of Somalia, practicing takedowns on a ship, where we would come alongside and drop a SEAL team down on fast ropes onto the deck of the ship to take the ship over. So you can tell from the context of the story, this was happening during when all the Somali piracy was going on.
Yes. Yes.
So we got to go do fun things like that with people who shall not be named. And I remember that particular evening just because I couldn't believe that I was doing what I was doing. More so, I couldn't believe that I was capable of doing what I was doing. I compare that flight on that night to being, you know, a professional quarterback at the Super Bowl, throwing the game-winning touchdown at the end of the game where, you know, you just wrapped it all up and you realize that you really had to be at some extremely high level of proficiency and professionalism to even be able to do something like that, much less succeed at it.
Right.
And that was great. And I remember sweating buckets the whole time, but it was fun. We consider fun or kind of weird sometimes.
No. I think for people in those type of positions, you look at the exhilaration of it. And so my question though is, were there a lot of those times where you took a moment to reflect about, wow, I'm actually here doing what I'm doing, or you just get through it and then realization kind of hits you?
I've spent more time reflecting on what I've done after I've done it. But, you know, much more after I've retired, because when you're in the middle of it, I don't say you can't, but I say you don't take the time to analyze it and really realize what it is you're doing and how special it is.
Well, and in some ways, I would think that if you're trained properly, your mind shouldn't go to those places. You're locked in on what you're doing in the mission, because if your brain takes a moment to reflect other things, then it breaks your mindset of what you're doing.
Military pilots are taught to compartmentalize. So, you know, we take whatever's bothering us and we stick it off to the side and deal with it later, but we're able to focus on the mission at hand so that we get home safely. It's a great coping skill. It's also not a great way of dealing with stress sometimes.
No, and that's probably, you know, and this is, and I'm sure in every country, but you hear a lot about how hard it is for military personnel to come back from deployment into civilian life. And they have a hard time adjusting because they're so used to compartmentalizing everything.
We're really good problem solvers, except when it comes to solving our own problems.
Yes.
We kind of just bury it down and keep going.
So now I'm looking at some of the things we discussed. So your wife is an elementary school teacher over there, correct?
She is. So I met her after I finished flying helicopters in California.
And I remember the weekend before you met her. You had called me. I forgot what aircraft. I think you just come off deployment or you got a break. And you were talking about you were going to go up to Canada for 3 days.
Yep.
Like, do you know anybody in Canada? You're like, no, I just want to go there. And then afterwards, you're like, I met this girl. And I was like, really? And the next thing I know, I'm at your wedding.
It was a couple of years later, but yeah. But I went. It was pretty linear. I'd stopped flying helicopters in San Diego, and I'd moved to Pensacola to be a flight instructor as a helicopter pilot there for the next 4 years. And I traveled to Canada on some frequent flyer miles that I'd built up while I was spending all my bachelor money over in Asia. And I went to Montreal, and I was drinking an Irish beer in a pub next to a college campus, and then she walked with her friend.
And you guys are still married, and obviously you two have survived many, many years and a few kids.
We have three daughters and a granddaughter.
Yeah. And your oldest one is in an Air Force in Colorado, correct? If I remember.
No. She was in the Air Force. She's no longer in the Air Force, and she's living in North Carolina now.
Oh, it's beautiful there.
Yep.
So is Colorado.
She's still in school.
So how's your youngest daughter? How old is she?
She's 17 now, Kathleen.
So I follow your second oldest daughter on Instagram. Yep. And she had a she had a scary moment. I think after you guys got back to Italy, she had an appendix rupture, maybe.
Yeah. She waited until we got to Italy before she decided it was time for her first major surgery. And you know, the Navy hospital here took great care of her. And, you know, she went in for one thing and came out minus an appendix.
Right.
It was a surprise to all of us. Let's just put it that way.
Yes. Is she more like you, or do you think she's more like your wife?
So our two youngest, one looks like their mom and is me on the inside. And unfortunately, well, I guess I'd be a pretty girl, because my baby, she's got me on the outside and her mama on the inside.
Yeah. So I'm trying to look at the other. So Deborah's actually teaching online now. She started back teaching, correct? I think it was, you were going to.
She's teaching, great. She's been teaching for 6 to 7 years now, I believe.
Right. But the school there, they've gone online teaching, correct? I think that's what
when the country of Italy said everyone has to, you know, restrict your movement, go home, and weather the storm until the infection rate goes down.
Right.
Until we get through the bad part of this disease, everyone stay home. Now, Italian kids are also using some online tools for education as well. But my daughter, Kathleen, she's at the high school with the DOD. So she's also taking classes online. But Deborah and her fellow teachers had to very quickly develop and deploy an entire online-based curriculum. Yeah. And my hat's off to them, because I know how hard they worked to make it happen.
Yeah.
It was ridiculous the amount of effort they went through to get this going. And it's admirable to see how well it's working.
You know, here, the colleges, I think for the most part, because now a lot of colleges do have online classes, but most of the colleges have had to suddenly train the other teachers to do online classes. But for the high school, junior high, and elementary schools here, like currently in my school, in the school district I live in, they're taking an extra week of spring break, or a couple of more weeks of spring break. And then I don't really know if they have a plan to what to do. And obviously, as you get younger, it may be a little bit more difficult to corral children to do something that they're not even used to. I would say probably the homeschooling moms here are probably not laughing, but you know, they're like, well, I've been doing this, so my kids aren't really missing any type of school.
Right.
But it's crazy.
Some kids learn much better in a classroom environment than they do one-on-one with the parent. And some do quite well learning with visual media.
Right.
I was a teacher myself for a few years after I retired, before I came back into working for the civil service.
Let's talk about that a little bit, because when you got out, did you immediately go to Jacksonville? I forget.
I did. So when I left California, I moved to Pensacola, got married, flew my living butt off for 4 years straight and loved every minute of it. Then we went to Texas for a year and a half. I was on the USS Inchon.
In Corpus.
Yep. It was the only U.S. Navy warship in Texas at the time. And now there's none. They turned it into razor blades. I'm okay with that. The ship was from a class of ship, an LPD. So it was a very old ship that was designed to haul troops across from the West Coast to Vietnam. They were also nicknamed McNamara's Nightmares. So the ship was purposely built to haul troops.
Right.
And it was, you know, 30 years later, not hauling troops, but hauling helicopters and mine countermeasure assets around. So it was an old ship, and it was time for it to go. But we had a really good cruise out of it for the last time. That was the only time I spent in my entire career in the Navy, 18 months, when I was not flying an aircraft.
The rest of
the time, 18 and a half years, was in the cockpit.
So from Corpus, then, did you go then to Naples?
Jacksonville. I went to Jacksonville.
Okay.
And I was a department head in another helicopter squadron on the USS Enterprise. So I deployed again twice with them. And that's when I ended up going off the coast of Somalia on yet another amphibious ship, the Ogden, which is the ship that my dad and I have in common. My dad was also in the Navy. He retired as a chief, petty right. officer. So when I let him know that I was on the Ogden, he said, "That's funny. I was on it too, you know, 30 years before I was." So that's the one ship my dad and I both served on.
That's pretty wild, though. That's pretty
It was
wild.
Impressive. I felt pretty proud about that, just having been on the same, walking the same decks as my old man.
Yeah.
And doing good stuff still. So I did that time, and then I went after my time flying helicopters the second time around, flying H-60s off of aircraft carriers. We decided we wanted to go overseas. I accepted orders to Bahrain. And then about 2 months before we were supposed to move to Bahrain, they moved all the military families out of Bahrain because of the terrorism threat was getting bad there.
Right.
So I ended up having to go alone.
Oh.
I went there alone for a year, and Deborah and the girls stayed home. Well, we had just purchased a house right before that event had happened. We wanted to have a place that was safe for Deborah and the girls to go back to in case things got bad in Bahrain.
Right.
So they had to go directly there instead of going to Bahrain first. But hey, plan B worked out. They ended up having to go live in Pensacola at a house we'd already purchased.
Right.
We didn't plan on a hurricane coming down through there and wiping the whole city out, though. And that's exactly what happened just
what
about
hurricane,
a month.
What day. Hurricane was that?
It was Hurricane Ivan.
Okay.
So my entire family from North Alabama came down, all my aunts and uncles and cousins and everybody else. Anybody had a pickup truck and a chainsaw. And
right.
We helped clear the city of Pensacola of trees so that we could load a moving truck in Florida, drag it over from Jacksonville to Pensacola, and move my family in, and then me disappear overseas.
Right.
It had quite the learning experience, learning how the construction industry works when it comes to repairing homes with wind damage and storm damage and everything else.
Yeah.
A year and a half later, I get orders to Naples, Italy. And I call up Deborah, and I'm like, "Hey, you want to go live in Italy?" She goes, "I thought we were going to Japan." Well, things happen in the Navy the way they do.
Yeah.
We were going to go to Okinawa. But then they decided it would be better for us to come to Italy. And I agreed because, I always wanted to live in Italy.
Right.
We came over and the babies were babies. And we lived through the trials and tribulations of being young, uninformed Americans on the Italian economy in Naples. Had cars stolen. People trying to steal our stuff. We moved on to the base finally for security. And despite all the bad things, there were so many great things that happened while we were here
right.
that we really wanted to come back. The time came for me to retire in 2010, and we moved back to Jacksonville because the job market was better there than in other places. And in 2010, the job market wasn't good anywhere.
Right.
I got a job teaching high school while looking for work for Deborah because they were looking for someone to start an aerospace career academy as a voc tech teacher.
That's pretty cool, though. But, you would think that, yes, it's Jacksonville, so that would make sense. But I think that's pretty cool.
Yeah, there aren't very many aviation-centric career voc tech programs. This was one of the brand new ones that they started, and they hired me to do it. Quite frankly, because the guy they had originally picked got recalled to active duty and they were scrambling. So I go where I'm sent and I follow the path that's given to me, and it usually works out pretty well. I don't
right.
complain, I take it. So I taught high school for 5 years. I built a career academy. It was successful. It was rewarding for me personally and for the kids also. I thought I was teaching them how to fly airplanes and become aviation mechanics, but apparently what I was teaching them how to do was to enlist in the military. I taught over 500 kids, and probably 300 of them joined the military.
Really?
Yes, it was ridiculous, the number that joined the military.
But I think, doesn't that say a lot about your ability? Not that you were consciously recruiting them, but I think that says a lot about you representing the U.S. Navy pretty well.
Possibly. It also probably had something to do with the fact that I would bring recruiters in twice a month to the classroom. because they would, and when they came in, they had to bring something for the students.
Right.
So they were always some free swag that they'd take around and show off to the rest of the high school. And they go, where'd you get all that from? Oh, Mr. Cooper's class. He's got the recruiters in there again. Well, can I come next time? It was a good job, but I needed to move on because the leadership had changed at the school and they weren't quite supporting the program the way that they told me they would.
Right.
And I didn't want to stick around and see something that had become so good fail because I couldn't fix it without support. So
right.
I left and I took advantage of another opportunity that had presented itself to come back to the Navy, you know, where I was born and raised. I was a Navy brat from birth. I was born at Millington Naval Air Station.
And that's for people out there that's outside of Memphis that don't know.
Yep. Yeah, that's my roots to Memphis start at birth.
That's pretty cool, though.
Yeah. Well, the hospital's a parking lot now, so they didn't want to make the same mistake twice. So we went. I taught high school. We talked about the job opportunities, and I accepted a position as the Air Operations Deputy at Mayport Naval Station. So. Noticing a trend in my career choices lately, everything has to do with aviation.
Yes.
I had decided that I wanted to be in aviation forever, and I didn't care necessarily what the job was. As long as I was near airplanes and airports, I could be happy.
Right.
So the job in Mayport is several helicopter squadrons there, a runway and a pier facility. So I got ships, got helicopters, I got airplanes, I got an airfield. What's not to like?
Exactly. Exactly.
And then an opportunity came to come back to Italy. So I worked in Mayport for almost 5 years. And then just last summer, we took the plunge, sold our house, packed everything we owned, and shipped it to Italy. And here we are.
And here you are.
In the middle of coronavirus central.
But you're smiling, you're laughing. You guys are making the best of it, I think?
Well, my wife is gainfully employed. I'm gainfully employed. My 19-year-old's taking university classes online, saving me a whole lot of freshman dorm fees and all that. So
exactly.
And she's here with us. The 17-year-old, she says, I'm back where I belong, because she was a brat. She was a Navy brat, used to, you know, people that are different, just like her.
Right.
That's a hard thing to understand if you've not lived that lifestyle.
That's
that
true.
You don't really fit in many places that you go unless you're with a bunch of other people that don't fit in either. Then suddenly you're home.
Right.
And you know, military brats, they travel the world, they go and see things, and people don't believe they've seen the things that they tell them they've seen, but
sure.
It's true, you know. But and it just she just fit right in with her friends here. She's very happy.
Did she still have friends that she kept in touch with from there?
No, not really, because she was six when we left.
Oh.
There's one family here that they had a kid who the girls remember, and he's back now also. He's a high school senior. So they remember the one kid in the entire school that's still there that was there when we were here 10
right.
years ago. They were all family.
Where's one place in the world that you haven't gone yet that you'd like to go?
Egypt.
Me too. Me too.
I'd like to go. I've been to Africa, but I haven't been to Egypt. I'd like to go there, and I'd like to go to Israel.
Me too. I would like anywhere really in that area. I'd love to go in Africa as well.
I think the year of living in the desert in the Middle East helped me understand that there's a whole other thing to that culture that is very appealing, and it's welcoming. You know,
it
you
is.
You don't have to be a Muslim to be comfortable in the Middle East.
Right. And you said you lived in the desert for a year?
I lived in Bahrain for a year.
Oh, that's right. Is that where I remember talking to you one time and you said that you had been out for several days living with a Bedouin family? I remember.
That was actually off of a deployment. It was
Yes.
It was an overnight event. It wasn't several days. It was just overnight. It felt like several days after getting off that camel, though. So yeah, sort of rode a camel through the desert, went to a Bedouin tent where, you know, we had a traditional Arabic meal in the tent, and rode four wheelers and dune buggies across the desert to a wadi, a spring, and went swimming in the coldest water I've ever been in my life in the middle of a 130-degree desert.
Why was it so cold?
It was an underground.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was coming up nice and cold. That and the temperature difference between that and the air was pretty significant either way.
Wow.
It was an exciting experience.
So, where do you see yourself in 5 years?
Well, I won't be here in 5 years because civil service employees are limited to 5 years of overseas service.
Really?
They have to return back to stateside.
I did not know that.
It's got this really interesting name called the 5 year rule. Crazy, isn't it?
So where do you think you'll go after Italy then?
I'll be back in Mayport at my old job or at another similar job in that area because I have return rights to my old position. That's part of the incentive of civil service to me was that I could travel for work and go experience different cultures
right. And
maintain continuity in a career field.
That's pretty interesting because I wasn't aware of that at all.
Yeah. And, you know, Kathleen's talking about going to State Department now. So, you know, who knows? She may be an ambassador one day and president the next.
So do you remember, I think we had political science classes together, not the whole way through college, but do you remember our professor, George Kia?
Of course I do. Yeah.
Okay.
International politics guy.
Yes. So he, this last summer, last August, he took a position here in Houston at Texas Southern University. So
he was one. He was, yeah.
He's cool. The dean of public affairs here. I haven't talked to him yet. I was planning on doing that when the coronavirus kind of popped in. But I follow Texas Southern on Facebook, and last August they did a welcoming ceremony for him, and I kind of like took a moment to like stare at the screen, and then so he's the dean of public affairs here. So I'm very excited. He's had a pretty illustrious career. So I'm pretty excited to hopefully get to see him soon before I leave. So
I learned a whole other way of thinking from that man.
You know, I talk about a couple of people that really influenced the trajectory of my life, and he was a huge part of that. And being a woman, for me, going into a classroom that were mostly males, and being from a small town, like all of you had read stuff I'd never even heard of. But he was very fair about as long as you could support your argument, then that's really, he taught me how to argue. He taught me how to debate. He also taught me that my opinion was important.
But it's not always right. He teaches you how to be humble there a little bit.
He does.
He taught me a lot about how to, to assume another person's perspective that's maybe not the same as mine and just think about it for a while before you say anything and see if you can find the merits in their view.
And also just, you know, I think some people, it was shocking that you would listen to him. For those out there that don't know, he was from the country of Liberia, and he also ran for president of Liberia a few years ago, and he stepped out of the race at the last minute because there was a woman that was pretty higher up running, but he took himself out of the running closer to the election. But, you know, people would think that he would be very opinionated, but he was so good. And when he was at Memphis State, he was probably in his early 30s, I'm thinking. But he was already, just the way he interacted with the students was pretty special because he really just set the environment for us to really talk and communicate and learn to debate and stuff like that. So I really like that. But I was very excited when I found out he was living here.
Yeah, that's, I'd love to run into him again sometime.
So you and I both have a degree from Memphis State back before they changed their name.
Correct.
Do you get to watch a lot of our sports over there?
It'll always be Memphis State to me. I'm sorry.
I know. And I say the same thing. And, you know, it's, I love the fact that the basketball team, ever so often, they wear the throwback Memphis State jerseys. I love that. Because, yeah, it's always going to. Now, for me, though, I was there when it was University of Memphis. So I have a degree from the University of Memphis as well. But do you get to watch a lot of, well, I guess you, did you get to watch any of the football this past season over there?
Not this past season, but the two years before that I did.
Okay.
Turns out that when I took the job in Mayport, the guy I ended up working for was a Memphis State graduate.
Who was it?
His name is Scott Campbell, 10 years younger than me. He graduated from the ROTC unit.
Oh, he's 10 years younger than you. I don't think I know him then.
Probably not. We were from, you know, just far enough out of the loop.
Yeah.
Good dude. Love him. He was a big Memphis fan too.
Yeah. I love the fact that you can literally connect with people like that. Just instantly. I talk about that a lot. Okay. I'm going to end our interview now, unless there's something else you want to talk about.
Let's see. I did get my master's degree after graduated from Memphis. I went to MRIP and got a master's degree in air transportation management.
Yes.
And I did that because I realized what I wanted to be when I grew up finally. I decided I didn't want to grow up, so I'm just going to keep hanging around in aviation.
Well, you know, I think that especially in your early 20s, people really change and you really evolve and all the experiences you have kind of lead you in different directions. And I think you get to a point, because I mean, my career has kind of changed several things. And then I've kind of like circled back to the original in some weird way. But all that matters is that you love what you're doing. That's all that matters.
And that you give it your best shot.
Yes. Yes. Okay. I'm going to end this. Thank you. And I'm going to have you stay online for just a second, but thank you so much for having this conversation with me today. And I can't wait to get this published. So just hang on.
Okay.
Friends, I really hope you enjoyed today's conversation with retired Lieutenant Commander Stephen Cooper. We both really appreciate you taking the time out to listen in on our conversation today. I have so many more interesting conversations coming up in the next few days and weeks. And as a reminder, if you're not already subscribed to my podcast, I want to encourage you to do that today. I really don't want you to miss a single episode coming up. You can subscribe at southerngirlsview.podbean.com or on Apple Podcasts or iTunes at A Southern Girls View with Sandy Adams. You can also find me on iHeartRadio and Google Play Music. And if you're feeling extra warm and fuzzy today, I would be so grateful if you left me a review over on iTunes as well. Those reviews help people find my podcast, and they're also a really fun for me to go in and read. You can click the link in the show notes or go to iTunes, find my podcast, then select ratings and reviews and write a review. And let me know what your favorite part of the podcast is. Until next time, stay safe and have a fantastic rest of the day.